नित्यानन्दं परमसुखदं केवलं ज्ञानमूर्तिं द्वन्द्वातीतं गगनसदृशं तत्त्वमस्यादिलक्ष्यम् एकं नित्यं विमलमचलं सर्वधि साक्षीभूतं भावातीतं त्रिगुणरहितं सद्गुरुं तं नमामि।
We welcome all the Sri Mahants, Mahants, Kotaris, Thanedars, Samajis, Satsangis, Balasans, visitors and viewers to this Vakyartha Sadas conducted by the Balasans of Nityananda Gurukul. Today, the topic for the Vakyartha Sadas is, by its own existence, it expands into possibilities. Because of its existence and saying Tathastu to life, yes to life, life shows you the possibilities which you declare as denied to you. If life is interested in denying, it will not even show the possibilities to you in the first place. Its possibilities by being revealed to you itself, the yes is given to you. And your decision, expression to live is accepted, respected and encouraged. By you claiming life is not cooperating or supporting into what you want, you are denying the very revelations and expressions happen to you into your very consciousness. We will now be chanting the third verse of the Ishavasyopanishad.
Asuryana mate loka andhena tamasa vritaha tagumste pretya bhigacchanti ekecha atmahano janaha.
I have a question. If everything, life ultimately leads us to completion, then why is it that we have to decide something, like decide for life and decide based on the right context? Because anyhow, life will ultimately lead us to the space of completion, right? So any action we do will lead us to the space of completion. So why is it that we have to do anything, like decide for life and do it out of right context?
What I feel is when we don't set the right context and if we think that life will just take us to the right understanding and we just flow with life, we won't be able to flow with life, because without the right context, even if life guides us to the ultimate, we won't be so interested in knowing about the ultimate because we won't even have the right context. So when we set the right context, not only that we'll reach the ultimate in a nice smooth way, the time which we achieve the ultimate will also be reduced. So immediately the moment we set the right context, we'll be able to achieve the ultimate. Today in the satsang, Swamiji is speaking about Atmahana, that is killing the soul. But in Bhagavad Gita, it says that the soul cannot be killed. So what does Swamiji mean by this?
Okay, like how Swamiji himself told in the satsang today, any decision you take against life without having a right context for what it is, that is killing the soul.
But see, the soul is just made up of consciousness, and consciousness can't be destroyed and like killed in any way. So how can one small decision do something so big like killing the soul? Because it can't even be destroyed, right?
See, it is because you don't have the right context, and because you don't have the right context, you decide against life. By doing this, you are denying yourself. When you deny yourself, it is as good as killing your soul. So that's why Swamiji meant by Atmahana, means when you decide against your life, it is you killing the Atma.
And also, what do you mean by telling one small decision? That one small decision which you made for leaving Advaita or enriching the whole world, only you are here in Gurukul, right? So every decision which you make matters. So there's nothing like small decision, big decision. What I feel is that whenever you take a decision out of the right context, that will bring a huge change of completion in you. But whenever you make a decision out of no to life, that will again and again bring you some sort of incompletion continuously and put you in some or the other incompletion.
And context is much more powerful than the action you do. Even when you do an action, it's completely based on the context from which you do that. Like if you just say that Arjuna killed Karna in the Mahabharata war, it'll be like somebody might understand that Arjuna murdered Karna or something like that. But only when you say that he murdered from the context of reviving the Dharma and all that, then only the person who you're telling the Mahabharata story will understand that Arjuna did it just for restoring the Dharma instead of murdering him. So the action is completely based on the context from which you do it.
Okay, I have a question. See, suppose we do some act out of the right context, but it hurts the other person. And see, if anything hurts the other person, it'll bring us karma. But if we do it from the right context to help them, will it still bring us karma? Because we're doing it from the right context to expand them.
What I think is, in the first place, the moment you do something out of right context, it will never hurt someone. Because when you do it in the right context, the person who's next to you, he'll understand from what space you're trying to convey something. For example, now he has did something inauthentic. He has did a mistake, and we're trying to make him reinvent himself. When you do it from a space of deep compassion towards him, that you are showing a selfless love towards him by correcting him. When you have that as your context, and when you want him also to evolve and make sure he's not doing any such mistakes, or completing with this pattern of doing that mistake, when you do this, the person who's next to you, he'll surely realize that you are doing it from the space of love, not from the space of anger. So when you do things out of right context, naturally the person who's next to you will feel that you are doing it from the right context, and he won't get hurt.
And what I feel is, when you do something from the right context, maximum the person who's feeling hurt, only their powerlessness will feel hurt. They themselves will never feel hurt. Because at that time, they are running from the context of powerlessness. They won't be able to recognize that what you're doing is right, even though you do it from the right context. So it'll directly hurt only their powerlessness, which does not affect them in any way, only expands them. So it will not give you any karma.
Just as you told, I just want to add a point. Like, whenever there is some sort of real, like, making the other person complete, they might feel incomplete in the start. Like, they might get hurt immediately when you tell. But when they understand, see, if somebody makes a mistake, then it's always your responsibility that you make sure the other person is becoming more and more authentic. So that is doing the thing from the right context. But sometimes when you tell it to them, they might get very hurt. Oh, why is he speaking like this? Why is he doing such actions? But that is the right context. So what I feel is that right context might get some incompletion in you, but then, as Swamji told, always right context is soft power, which is continuously dealing with patience. So continuously, you don't give up on the other person. Like, at one point, you just tell him, no, you should not do this, and then you leave it. That is not the right context. But again and again, not giving up on the person until he becomes authentic, continuously restoring him, is what I feel is the real doing things from the right context.
But see, now if you're poking somebody in the city, at that time the person thinks that the incompletion is part of them. So at that time, when the person thinks that the incompletion is part of them, you poke that. So at that moment, when they feel hurt, even though you're doing out of the right context, you're actually hurting them, not the incompletion, because they think that incompletion is part of them. So now, because they think that incompletion is part of them, so it's directly hurting them, not the incompletion, because they think that incompletion is part of them.
See, what I understand is, but finally, you just don't poke their inauthenticity and just leave. You make sure you speak to them and you transform them, right? So when you speak to them, that person will surely understand that you have did it just to transform them. So when they complete with that, obviously you'll not get karma, because they'll... What I feel is, they'll feel gratitude towards you because you'd have made them come out of their inauthenticity and transform. So I don't think this will get any karma, because at that time, though they associate themselves with their incompletions, once you just don't poke their inauthenticity and leave off, you go and speak to them. So once they understand, that doesn't get you karma, is what I understand.
But when they feel the hurt at the first place, you do get karma because you're hurting the other person at the first point, right?
In Cambodia, when we were having a question and answer session in Swamji, somebody asked this question. Swamji, I did it. I actually spoke to the person from the context to have exploring whatever you spoke. But that person got into a quarrel and felt hurt. So he asked, will I get karma by that? So I'm told, it also depends on your intention. It doesn't just completely depend on the effect. It also depends on your intention of the action, which will decide whether you get karma or not.
And also, after you speak to them, after poking their inauthenticity, after you speak to them, obviously they'll completely drop their incompletion and they'll drop their inauthenticity. So that time, their cognition completely changes and they don't feel hurt for what you did to them. They'll feel gratitude instead. So that doesn't create any bad effect on you.
I have...
But see, you still like hurt them. You hurt them and then you completed them. So won't you get bad karma and good karma?
What I feel is you will not get the bad karma because the context in which you are enriching that person matters. If you are enriching in a good context, the other person has to transform and you are poking them. What I feel is that when you are giving the right context to them after that, they will understand immediately. So I don't feel that when they are getting hurt after you poking will give you any bad karma because the context in which you are doing matters at that time.
See, in that case, if you see, like if somebody gets a wound and then they have some sort of pus coming out of their leg, like when you touch it, yes, it will pain. But the intention from which you are doing is just to heal the other person, right? So what I feel is that whenever you catch somebody's inauthenticity, whenever you show that, see, there is a wound, I'm here, I'll help you remove it. I'll help you heal it. Then naturally at that point, like when you medicate something, yes, the other person will feel hurt. But naturally, you need to understand that it's only for him to become more and more better. So what I feel is that, see, and also it is not like you just open the wound out and leave him and go away. You always put the medicine also and make sure it is healed. So what I feel is, whenever you do things from the right context, like for example, you are shouting at somebody. See, that can be from hard power, that can be from soft power also. Whenever you do it out of the right context, when you shout at somebody, that person might get hurt at immediate that point itself. But whenever you take the responsibility, as Swamiji told, it brings lots of patience in you. So without giving up on the other person, making sure at the end, till the end, the person is in the space of completion, continuously working and making sure he comes out the incompletion is what will not get, that is why it will not get any karma to you is what I feel.
I have a question. Is it only the right or wrong context that brings you karma?
What I feel is yes, the karma comes because of it depends upon what kind of context you have. It can be wrong or bad. That depends upon how you are and what kind of context you have at that time. See, I just have a story. There'll be a sage, okay? So when he was walking, there'll be a man sleeping under the tree, okay? At that time, what happens is when you're sleeping, there'll be a snake which enters his mouth. Knowing this, the sage actually goes, takes the mud from the ground, takes the apple, rotten apple which is there on the ground, he stuffs inside that man's mouth. But the man doesn't understand what he is doing. He'll start cursing that sage and what he is doing. He'll be pushing and like throwing his anger without knowing what the sage is doing. But finally, when all the mud, everything went into his stomach and when he vomited, including the snake came out, then he understood what he actually did, from which context he did. So I think that whatever action you are doing, it depends upon the right context, which brings you karma or zero, is what I feel.
So even if you do something out of a wrong context and the other person avoids getting hurt, you'll still get karma?
Can you give an example for your question?
Okay, see, like before I joined Gurukul, whenever I used to tell, like I used to tell my friend something, but I used to tell her out of anger or shout at her. I didn't really want to transform her. But then still she listened, like if I tell her to do something, she did listen to me. Though I told it out of anger, my friend did listen to me and she didn't get hurt. But still my context was not right. It was out of anger and not from the space of transforming her, right?
See, what I feel is that you're not really aware whether she got hurt or not. Because what I feel is, whenever you do anything out of the wrong context, see, anything you do out of wrong context will get incompletion in others, is because you have some sort of incompletion in you which comes out as wrong context. So when you throw some incompletion on others, naturally, unless and until they are in the high space of completion, it will make them also incomplete. So what I feel is that whenever you do any action out of wrong context, naturally that will put that person in the space of incompletion, unless and until they are in a very high space of completion.
I have a doubt. Okay, see, when Satsang Swami told, when you don't have any conflict in what you're doing, then that will be always right. If it's from a bad context, then how is it that we'll avoid getting karma?
See, anything you do from a context which is other than soft power or inspiration, it will either put guilt or fear into you because you did it from a wrong context. But when you do something out of a right context, from soft power, from inspiration, then it will always bring you and whatever you did, completion and happiness.
What I feel is we can't make a decision, as you told, you told any action we do from the wrong context without conflict, is it still right? Right, but I don't think so. I don't think we can even make any, do anything from the wrong context without any conflict. Like, for example, suppose we want to steal from someone or something like that, and we have no conflict in that, you're saying it's right. But I don't think so, because in that situation, you wouldn't have made that decision without getting any conflict inside you.
Also, what I feel is that when you know that your action is not bringing any conflict, that means you're doing it out of the right context only.
After that, will our soul will be killed? See, we have karmas, then we died. Then even then, our atma will be killed after that.
Like in Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna says that the atma can never be killed. So I don't think Swami literally meant that the atma will be killed. What I think is Swamiji meant that instead of living your life from the space of completion, you'll start living your life from the space of incompletion and everything. And you'll never take decisions from the completion space inside you.
Just adding a point to Tattva Maharaj, what I understand is when we accumulate more karmas, we'll fall into the vicious cycle of birth and death. So still we complete with all of our karmas and get liberated, we'll constantly have this birth and death. So the more we accumulate karmas, it's not that we'll kill our soul, but instead of being in the space of completion, we'll accumulate more karmas and fall into the vicious cycle of birth and death.
If we remember the context of whatever we are doing, will that burn all of our karmas?
I don't think the moment you remember the context for which you are doing this will burn all our karmas. It is like this. The moment you remember a context and do the things which you aspired for, you won't accumulate any more karmas in your future or in the present. But whatever karmas you already accumulated, you have to go through that. But the moment you understand the right context and decide for life and continue to live, You won't accumulate any more karmas in your life, in your future or in the present.
Just adding to Adinath Maharaj's point, what I understand is once you start deciding from right context, you stop accumulating karmas. So because you start deciding everything from right context, the space, it just creates completion. So Master himself will come and burn all our karmas. So there's no need of we even going through our karmas, because we start living in completions once we decide from right context. So Master himself will come and burn our karmas.
I have a question. In one of the Upanishad satsangs, Swamiji told that whenever you decide for life, deciding for life is the only way where you can burn all your karmas. So does that mean that whenever your future, whenever you're deciding for life and you do every action based on it, will your past also be complete?
What I feel is yes, because Swamiji told the essence of this Upanishads is just deciding for life. And Swamiji also told in the Upanishad, they clearly declare not only in the future or in the present you'll be complete, even the past you are always complete. Unlike the Yoga Sutras and the other sutras, only the Upanishads can declare that even in your past you are always complete. So by living that always saying to life, always saying yes to life, you can complete your past also.
Adding to Ajay Ramaji's point, now instead of accumulating new karmas in the future, you'll be focused on fulfilling your past karmas, so then when you decide for life, you'll not accumulate anything in the future, and also your past will start becoming complete.
I have a doubt. Is saying no to life accumulating karma?
What I feel is yes, because Swami once told karma is something which you get when all your actions are not aligned to your concept of life. So when you say no to your life, your context, your whatever actions you do is not aligning to your concept of life.
I have a question from today's morning satsang. Like Swami told, when we are in this time, like my purpose is to become, like what Swami used, like if you wanted to be a, if your purpose in wealth, so I first aspire for wealth, okay? Then I feel, oh, if I get the politician seat, I'll get more, I'll enjoy all that. But why, when we go to the next step, why do we forget the context?
See, what I feel is that each one needs to ask that question towards themselves, because each one's reason of why they forgot the context might be due to different incompletions they had. So what I feel is that whenever you remember the right context and do any action, then naturally whatever you do will be in the space of completion.
I have a doubt. When others decide to suffer, why do we get karma?
What I think is, even though they decide to get hurt, it's you who had the wrong intention of hurting them, right? It's because of your wrong intention is what I think you get the karma for it.
And also what I feel is that, see, though at many times you may not be directly reason for somebody suffering, but if something around you is happening, that means you wanted to see it, you wanted that to happen in your life, that is why it's happening in front of you. So if you see somebody is suffering, that means that you are supposed to take some responsibility to make sure that that person is getting complete or whatever you can do at that moment. Like suppose you're in the car ride or somewhere and then you see somebody fighting. So you might not be able to directly do something, getting down and going and solving the problem. But what I feel is that just creating an intention within you, just feeling that, okay, whatever might be, let them just become complete. Just that one small decision and cognition which you have inside you will create such a big vibration of love which will complete them. So what I feel is that whenever around you, all the things around you happens only for you to take responsibility for it. So whenever you don't take responsibility for it, you are saying no to life and so you accumulate karmas.
I have a doubt. If someone's life is for becoming wealthy, for example, a thief, when he steals, the purpose he steals is to become wealthy, right? But when he steals, will it bring karma? Because for him, life will be to be wealthy, right? But when he steals, it will still bring karma. So will he not get the karma?
What I think is yes, because his purpose is to achieve wealth, but not by hurting someone. He can still get the wealth by working or enriching someone. And when he enriches someone, someone can give him as an offering to him. When he does it in the right way, when he has the right context for doing things, he won't get karma because he wants to achieve wealth. But whereas when he's stealing, he doesn't have right context. He is hurting someone. So when he's hurting someone, he's deciding against life, and by doing that, he's getting karmas.
I have a question. Now, will anything you do in the right context not bring you karma? Because now, for example, now if you're like living in a very cold place where like there's no electricity, like if you're like going somewhere where there's no electricity and you need some warmth. So at that time, when you go get firewood, like cut the trees and get firewood and light a fire for yourself to keep yourself like alive and healthy. So you're doing that context of keeping your body alive and keeping yourself like proper. So that's actually the right context. So at that time, because you're cutting the trees, will you still get karma or zero?
What I feel is, no, because one time Swami told that for each existence, they feel pain, but there'll be different frequency of their feeling pain. For the plants, it'll be very low compared to the living beings and the animals. So what I feel is, even if you're going to cut a tree, the effect of art being there so much where you will not get karma.
What I feel is it's also based on the context from which you're cutting the tree. See, if you cut the tree just for like the amount which is needed for keeping you alive, then it will not bring you any karma. But if you think that I want to go cut all the trees, out of that madness you just go cut all the trees, it will bring you karma. Because you're not doing it because of the right context, you're doing it out of the context. So if you align everything to the right context, there's no possibility of you getting any karma.
I have a question. Just few statements ago, Nandita was telling that that till your aspirations get complete, till you finish off your karmas, you will still be in a cycle of birth and death, right? So Swamiji also told in today's satsang that only if you complete all your aspirations, you will be liberated. Then is karma and aspiration the same?
What I think is karma and aspirations are not same. But when you live with without the right context, when you live your aspiration without the right context, it'll lead you to karma. Basically, your karmas are the desires which you want to have in your life. When you feel something is not part of your life, you have a desire about that. And when you get that, when you don't have the same context with what you aspired, when you live without the right context how you aspired it, you will get karmas. So basically, when you don't have the context, you don't get karmas. Like when you have context, you'll be complete with your whole life.
But aspiration is also the same, right? Which you feel it's not part of you, you want it. That is also aspiration, right?
See, giving an example, like you see somebody doing blindfold and you feel that, oh, I also want to do blindfold. So that's an aspiration which you created in yourself. And when you keep telling to yourself, oh, how will I be able to do blindfold? I cannot even read properly with my both eyes open. Then how will I be able to do blindfold? No, blindfold is not for me. When you keep telling that and you create some sort of bondage between you and doing that blindfold, then that is what brings karma in you. Like how Swamiji told in today's satsang, in the recorded satsang, that whenever you see, whenever there's a life gives you a hope, that itself means that you can do it. But when you keep denying that, no, how will I be able to do and all that, then that is what brings you more and more karma, and that is what puts you in more and more incompletion. So this is what I feel is the difference between karma and aspirations.
Will the right context bring right listening, or will the right listening bring right context?
Okay, so what I feel is that when you have the right listening, automatically the right context will come to you. And when you have the right context, automatically listening will happen. So both lead to each other.
But if you don't have the listening, then how can you even set a context?
See, when maybe in last Haridwar, before coming to Gurukul, I attended NDMS in Haridwar. So there, actually I went there and I was not in the mood that I want to go back to home. But even after NDMS, I will go back in that context. I just went in the sake of my parents told. So you just spend time and go back home. Because of that, I went there even during the engineers class, and the class is going on. I will not listen to the class at all. Around 18 days, the total engineers program is around 21 days. 18 days I didn't listen. I'll be just sitting, and I will not eat any food because I don't like any food there. I will not do anything. I'll be just like one person just sitting and dreaming there. Or doing something, I'll be just sitting like that. So one after 18 days, I really the some click after the satsang when Swamiji spoke, and do the all the 18 days darshan which Swamiji gave, some click came on me. I'll try to listen to the class. Once the last three days I listened to the class. Only after 18 days, the past 3 days I listened to the class. Just in 3 days. When I listened to the class authentically, I was able to get the right context for me to what is life. I was just thinking life is just I will just enjoy and my life is just Maya. I'll just in Maya. I don't think that I am part of spirituality. I'll just be roaming around there and there. But after the engineers, when I listened only for 3 days, I got the right context. And because that context which I got only, I was able to come to Gurukul itself.
So what I understood from your experience is that, like, even if you have no context, even if you have no listening, somehow if you make it to inner awakening for kids or inner awakening for adults, then naturally that will set the right context and get you the right listening also. So this is what I understood from your experience.
I have a question. What exactly is the right context? Is the right context depend? Does the right context depend on what you think is the right context, or is something set as the right context?
What I feel is, whatever you have your purpose of life, like whatever you think is your purpose of life, just aligning to it again and again and deciding for it is what I feel is right context. So whatever you do should be like aligning to your purpose of life. That's what I feel is right context.
Adding to her point, Swamiji said there's no one to judge whether anything is right or wrong. It's you who makes the decision. So adding to her point, like she told, it has to align to the context of your life.
So basically, right context is you knowing why you do what you do. That's what. So you setting a right context is before you do something, you're just knowing why you are doing that. By doing this, how are you going to enrich others, or how is it aligned to your purpose? That's what is called as right context.
Okay, but I have a doubt. Based on others and life only, you can decide the right context, right? It doesn't come directly from you. Because if you're a thief, you'll think stealing from others is the right context for you to get whatever you need. So in that case, if you think that stealing is the right context, but as per the cosmos, stealing can never be the right context when you want something. Creating a space and getting what you want will be the right context. So in that case, how is the thief's right context is stealing? Because that can never be a right context, right?
Even though he steals, you told right that even stealing from the right context, that he had that right context, how it will be wrong? Actually, if you see, stealing itself is not wrong, but if you steal the person who, for example, I steal from somebody, the person, if they get hurt, the suffering, which they're having the suffering, that itself shows that the person who stole didn't have any right context. Well, he just steal for his greed and...
Just adding to his point, like what Swamiji told in Cambodia, he was telling that, for example, if you steal from a person whose salary is a billion, like 1 million in a month, okay? So if you steal from that person, they'll not at all feel bad about it. But if you steal from a poor man who gets only like 100 rupees per month, if you steal from that person, he will obviously feel hurt because he's already so poor. So that will get you karma, and that'll be wrong as per the cosmic law.
So basically what we want to get at this point is not that steal anything you want from the right context, but then whatever you want, when you do it from the right context, naturally that will align you to your purpose and make you more and more complete. So this is what I just wanted to add from the whole conversation which went on now.
But I still don't think my question is answered. Okay, I'll give a better example. Like for example, somebody says something to you and you feel hurt for that. So your cognition might be, when somebody hurts me, I have to hit them back. So for you, the right context for this type of response to you, you'll always try to hit them back. So for you, the right context will be defending yourself by hitting them back. So in this case, how is hitting them back a right context? Because in the case of this boy, he might be thinking that only after you hit someone else, they'll understand that what they did is wrong, instead of giving them understanding. So in a boy in this case, when he hits somebody only, he thinks it's the right context and they'll understand that they are hurting him. So when he feels that hitting others is the right context, is it really the right context or the wrong context?
See, what I understand is like why you try to give them back is just like for you to be happy and for you to make him understand that what he did was wrong. But by you hitting that person, he's not going to understand that what he did was wrong. So like it'll just create more incompletion in him and more incompletion in you. So in that space, you'll not experience any completion by you hitting or taking revenge. But instead, when you go and take responsibility, just feeling that person as an extension of you and speaking to them, then it'll enrich him and put you also into the space of completion. Like how Swamiji told, when in Varanasi, he'll show that love, like Mahadeva's love current flow through him. So when he fills all of us in that love current, and when he gives like initiations and all in that space, it'll be like we'll feel every Advaita with everyone. So in that space, every time we decide for life, it'll not just be our life, it'll be like everybody's life and our life. When we decide for our life, everybody will fall into the space of completion. So like when you decide for life and you go and enrich that person, it'll put both of you into the space of completion is what I understand. So rather than hitting that person back, we can enrich them and put them also into the space of completion.
Just adding to her, when you hit a person from the context that from the powerlessness that I should defend myself, then that will not lead to more completion. But like Kalabhairava, when he cut Brahma's head, it was out of the powerfulness to and the right context to enrich Brahma to drop his ego. So even then, when he cut Brahma's head, it actually made Brahma more drop his ego. So it depends on that context. The person, when he hits for defending, it's out of powerlessness.
I have a question. Like, if somebody is very clear that whatever they're doing is not something wrong, like many of them from outside, they think that most of them don't even know, are not even aware that whatever they're doing has some sort of incompletion in it and puts them in the space of incompletion. See, like though they are inauthentic, they don't even feel that they are inauthentic. So what does that mean? Does it mean that working out of the right context?
I feel if the person does things inauthentically and he knows what is the truth, then it's just out of his arrogance. But if the person does not know the truth and is being inauthentic, it's just he's working out of ignorance, and we should just be enriching him and making him understand the truth.
And what I feel is the person who is in incompletion, there's also a complete part in him. So when there's a complete part in him, there's also there might be a satsanga around him. So when he sees the satsanga, he'll know what is right and what is wrong. Whatever the satsanga does is right, whatever the dusanga does is wrong. So when he, even after understanding that the right and wrong, when they still do it wrong, it's still from the wrong context. So after understanding right and wrong, if you still decide to do the wrong thing, it is from the wrong context.
I have a question with what Ajay Maharaj said. See, when you know you're doing something inauthentic, and like, see, when you're doing something inauthentic, obviously you'll attract people who are inauthentic, right? Then how can satsanga happen around you?
As I told, it's not that you're completely incomplete. There's also a completion part in you which will always raise you to understand, to be with the satsanga always and not fall into the dusanga.
I'll just share my experience. Before I came to Gurukul, just if my grandmother makes me so get angry, I'll just go. She'll try to hit me. But before she hitting me, I'll just start hitting her. Okay, then after that, I'll just start crying. Because she made me so much anger, I just hit her. I'll just go to one corner of the house. I'll just start crying. So after that, after I came to know Swamiji, when I came here for the Gurukul, then I understood. So when I did before, it was not out of love. So when I did it, after I understanding why hitting my grandmother will not be love, so I just need to sit with her and speak to her that don't do this to me. So instead of getting angry, I just give her understanding. So this is what I understand.
I have a question. See, like students, like in one of the satsangs, Swamiji told that passion is hard power and patience is soft power, right? But we become passionate about something because we get inspired about that. So like inspiration is soft power. So how is when we decide out of right context and we'll get inspired, so it'll be out of soft power, right? So how is being passionate hard power, and how is patience soft power?
Before that, I have a question on what you said. In what context did Swamiji actually say that passion is hard power this morning?
What I understood is like in that satsang, Swamiji was speaking about like hard power is basically out of fear and greed, and then soft power is out of inspiration. So like after that, he made a statement like he just told that hard power is passion and soft power is having patience. So like what I understood out of that was like, so if hard power is out of fear and greed, will passion also be out of fear and greed? So like, because passion is usually like out of inspiration, right? That is why we even become passionate about something. So like this is what I understood from what Swamiji told. I have a doubt on this.
I don't really know what's the exact answer for this. So we shall get back on this tomorrow.
So in our whole life, when we do things out of the right context, will that lead us to the ultimate?
What I think is when we keep doing things out of the right context, we'll be naturally deciding for life. And when we keep deciding for life, we will reach the ultimate space.
Like when I understood the right context for doing something, but at times I feel like there's no need to do out of the right context. Let's just do it simply without the right context. Then that time, what is it that's stopping me to follow up with the right context?
What I feel is you got used to be like you're completely used to be like you know, not, I'll not do anything from right context and everything. The more and more you decide for life and do things from right context, though you feel that no, I should not do from right context and everything, that is the point where you have to decide for life and take a decision for life and live with the right context. So at that point when you decide, naturally you will become as permission told, naturally it will become part of your life.
I just wanted to share my experience. Like before I joined Gurukul, like though I knew that getting angry or crying is not going to help me, but I didn't really want to apply that in my life. Like I thought that whenever I cry, I'll get whatever I want. So this was all the context which I was functioning. But after I came to ashram, when like the space, the context, like Swamiji, more than telling the actions, he gives us the right context. So just because he radiates the context and he lives it and shows, more than the action which we do, the context, he gives importance to the context. So when anything we do out of right context will lead us to the space of completion and will expand us and lead us to the ultimate. So when Swami gave this understanding, more than me crying, like I knew the context why I should not cry, and rather than that, why I should be powerful. So when I got this right context and when I started applying this right context, I was like, I knew that powerlessness will not help me, and now I'm able to be more powerful and get things done being in the space of powerfulness.
Okay, I would like to answer Moksha Maharaj's question. I don't agree with what Satyamaya told, because in this question itself, yes, very clearly he told, he knows that he has to follow the right context, but he told it's okay, why should I follow the right context, let me follow it like this. In his statement, it is clearly showed it is his laziness and his pure arrogance which is stopping him from making him to not follow the right context. It is not that he has to decide for living right context more and more times. It is not that he doesn't have the willpower. It is his pure laziness and arrogance which is stopping him from not following the right context.
See, but what I feel is that, see, even you told that it is not that he has to decide for life again and again. See, only if you continuously decide for life again and again, then only you can go beyond. See, we understand that yes, it is laziness, yes, it is out of arrogance. But only if we continuously decide for life again and again, we'll be able to move out of that laziness and arrogance is what I feel.
See, as per Kamikagama, we are supposed to wake up at Brahma Murta, 4:30 a.m. in the morning. So even I know the context that whatever we do in Kamikagama, as per what Mahadeva told, so I am doing what Mahadeva told. Even though I'll wake up at 4:30, and I'll be sitting, even though I thought that Mahadeva told that my laziness will be disturbing me, that I have to sleep, I don't want to follow all this, I want to sleep, I'll be having that thought. So even though if I again decide, no, zero, I should not do that, and I should come out of it and wake up and go and take bath, if every day, for me, it continues every day. Every day when I wake up, I'll have this thought, I don't want to follow, I want to sleep. So even though if I continue to do that, the laziness pattern will break. After some time, if I continue doing that for a long time, after some time, I will not have that pattern. I will just get up, I'm waking up as per Mahadeva told, so I'll just wake up and go and take bath. So if you continue to say yes for life, the laziness pattern will break.
I also want to share one of my experience. Like this was few months ago, where I knew that before I start eating, I had to, like Swamiji told, you have to set, like whatever you do is enriching. So you have to commit to yourself that you'll enrich the person who is responsible for giving this food. So whenever I got my food in the plate, I will put the food in my mouth. Then only I'll remember, oh God, I have to do this. Then I'll realize, oh, why did I miss it again? So this went on for a few times and never I was able to decide again. So what I thought is, that's okay, even if I put it in my mouth now, let me now at least decide. Let me now at least start, even after I put food. So then after the food went in, after I chewed and swallowed, then I will do the same, the committing. But when I did this again and again, continuously, maybe for 3 or 4 days, then the moment I got my food itself, I knew, the moment I looked at the food, I understood that, yes, I have to enrich, I have to commit to myself to enrich the people around me so that everything happens. And because when I told that, when I decided to myself that whatever might be, decide for it. We might be continuously making mistakes. But unless, as Swamji tells, unless you take the decision to start now, it is never going to happen in your life. So when I understood what Swamji told and put it as my experience, put it in my action, then naturally I was able to go through the whole thing and I was in the space of completion.
Okay, see, I have a question. Like, whenever I hurt someone for a few times, like, I'll not want that person to be incomplete, but like, for just for the sake of telling that I don't want that person to be incomplete, I'll just tell, okay, completing with you. But it'll not be from the space of really completing that person and really transforming me. But just for the sake of telling, I'll just tell, okay, completing with you. But then still in that place, that person will not be incomplete. Like, in that case, that person will also be complete. That person will be like, yes, I'm complete. And she'll also tell that she's complete. So is it still that I'm deciding against life and out of like the wrong context?
What I feel is yes, because it might be only temporary completion with you, but might not be permanent completion. Like maybe in just one more day, because you did a wrong context, so maybe just after one more day, you both will again become incomplete. So if you complete her, like, totally, so what I feel is from then on, you guys will never have incompletion.
But she went and told her friend that she don't want to be incomplete there. So because of that sake of telling, she went and told, I'm complete with you. But still, she don't want to be incomplete with her, right? But still, she wants to complete. So it is designing for life, right?
See, the context depends, because see, at that point she can just say and her words can just make the other person complete temporarily, but the next day again they both will have some other problem and fight with each other, because there's no right context set in between both of them. She just completed for sake of just telling, no, she should not feel incomplete at that point, but she didn't completely complete with her to make her understand that what she did was not right.
What I feel is that when she just simply told, like, okay, I'm completing with you, if she really wanted to make the other person complete, then she would have sat and authentically completed with her and find out what is that from now onwards, whatever I do, which will make her complete. If she would have really done that, then never in her life would she ever be incomplete to that other person. But if she just simply told that, okay, now for the sake of completing, I'm just completing with you, she would have done that from some other context of trying to escape her, trying to, like, push the completion. From really becoming complete.
And also one more point which I want to add is that, see, whatever might be the other person, if they are in the space of completion, they may just understand that, okay, you are just trying to hide it under the carpet. So they might be in some other space of completion. Though your thing might not be able to affect them, but does not mean that you are not inauthentic. So you still have to take the responsibility to make sure that you are complete, because it's you who have to evolve to the next phase of completion. So with this, we come to the conclusion of today's Vakyata Sadas. We shall expand and continue on what Swamiji speaks in the further satsangs. Now we shall complete with the Purna Mantra.
Om. Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vasishyate Om Shanti 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 Harihi Om Tat Sat Sarvam Sat Guru Padukarpanamastu Om Nityanandam.